were you happy with the start of that race? There wasn't a false start or anything.
There was a false start. Leroy Burrell did a false start.
Was that given as a false start?
It was given as a false start. Right. And the strange thing about, you know, that was the days when everyone was allowed two false starts.
Yeah.
So Leroy Burrell had a false start, and then you can see he was nervous because then he realized he has to hold, because if he goes again, he's going to get disqualified.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the rest of us was quite relaxed. And for me, my start, when I get to a championship, my start's always much better than it is when I'm training, because I just totally concentrate on the gun. And as we say, we're going to be at a bang. So when I got out, we got out in front of Leroy and he had to hold. And, you know, the rest was over. I mean, by the time I got to 60 metres, I knew I was going to win.
Atlanta, didn't you have two starts and got disqualified?
I had one.
You had one.
I had one. I still, to this day, say no, I had
just
one.
Just to put the record straight on that one, great as you were.
They told me I moved too soon after the gun. So does that generate a false start? I don't know. I mean, I didn't realise you can do that. So they said, my problem was I moved too soon after the gun.
Anyway, let's get back. You've got a goal, right. So just remind us, you just said it, 60 metres.
60 metres.
You're in front, and no one's going to catch you now, are they?
Well, no, I mean, Bruni Seren, I think, and maybe Frankie was a little bit in front of me at the time. But, you know, I just knew that their finish wasn't that strong.
Frankie came second.
Yeah. You know, and I mean, you know, for me it was a great thing. I mean, I didn't get as much joy, I got to say, from winning the Olympics as I did from the World Championships. You know, the Olympics was for, you know, like Ron and the guys I trained with, and more people think a lot more of it. But the World Championships gave me that much more pleasure.
We never talk about coaches, do we? And we should do, because they're so important. What was your coach's reaction then? You just said he got more out of it than me.
I mean, Ron was a great guy. You know, to this day, Ron's still one of my best friends. We phone each other, we hang out, we do, you know, he's at my house every Christmas. I mean, without Ron, I would never, you know, have made it. And people will say, oh, you know, if you had any coach you had, you would have been successful. We don't know that. You know, I got it through Ron and feathered my cap.
People quite rightly make a big thing, the oldest guy ever, 32. Did you stop at any point during the celebrations and think about the age?
No, I just thought, well, Zurich's next. You know, where do I go next? And to this day, I've never really had the time to sit down and say, oh, you know, really sit back and enjoy. I don't really watch my races and everything else like that, because then you become too complacent and everything else. And, you know, at the time, I still had more goals I wanted to achieve. So you win one race and, you know, that's it. You just got to go on to the next race. And that's how it was for us. You know, I mean, I'm sure you guys agree with it. You just got to go on to the next race and, you know, there's Grand Prix and everything else afterwards. And you've got to back up what you do. So that's the great thing, I enjoy about our sport. And that's when, you know, I feel that someone can say, you know, whether you're one of the greats or how good you are or whatever, you know, you do it and you don't rest on your laurels. You go back out again and you say, I dare you to come and try and beat me. And, you know, you back it up. And I think that's the pressure that we're all under after major championships, to go back and, you know, to try and do it again.
Sally, let's move on to your event. Now, you've messed up, the last hurdle the year before. You're not going to do it this time, are you?
No, and I think I got very annoyed with myself and just said, right, you know, what am I going to do? What's the difference, really? And I just worked on it mentally, really, for that whole year beforehand, just telling yourself you're good enough and, you know, just mentally preparing it. And, you know, going into it, it's just, you know, I think if you have any little doubt in your mind, then you might as well settle for second best or whatever. I knew that I had to really believe in what I could do out there in that performance.
Would it be fair to say you're on top of the game right from the very start of the competition?
Yeah, I mean, all the Grand Prix leading up to it, Sandra Farmer Patrick had very much won most of them. So I probably didn't go into the race as one of the favourites, which I quite liked. I think everyone thought that Sandra would win. But I also knew going into the competition that, you know, I was in best shape that I'm ever going to be in. This could only be my one opportunity, so I've got to make the most of it. I'd done every training session, I'd eaten well, you know, I'd ticked all the boxes. There was nothing else I could do. I just had to go out there and, you know, show them what I'm actually made of.
But in the first round, you were the only runner to get under 55 seconds, so that's starting right off.
Yeah, I mean, all the rounds, you know, with the four hurdles, you have to, it's quite difficult because you don't want to, you know, you've got to get the stride pattern. But at the same time, you want to conserve energy because you've got semi-finals and then a final. So that those first rounds are pretty difficult. But I just remember running that and feeling so easy and crossing the line and not even feeling out of breath and you know, running a half decent time and just thought, no, you're in shape, girl.
Now, Sally, I want you to take us through just before the race. You come out and you put your bag down. Remember what happened then?
I would have done one run over the hurdle, first hurdle, and then I would have lied down on the
Yeah,
floor.
looking at the sky. Why did you do that?
Why? Because I knew everybody else would be charging around and, you know, getting themselves all ready, and I knew I was ready. I knew I'd done everything. And I knew all that was left to do was just to relax and, you know, and I wanted to block out everybody. I didn't want to stand around looking at everybody. You know, Sandra's attack was to try and psych me out, you know, from right on seeing her on the bus on the way down, you know, the looks, the daggers. And that is what she was worried about me. And that is how she was going to try and win that race. And I just remember thinking, I'm not going to let you win this race, boy. I'm not going to let that get to me. So I was really conscious of just relaxing, shutting everybody out, and just, I knew exactly how I had to run that race.
So on the bus, you're coming all on the same bus. She's giving you that boxer sight.
Yeah, I just remember getting on and she was sitting on the bus and she literally looked me up and down and just was just trying to psych me out right from work day one. And you know, I knew she was worried about me. That's great.
Are you mates now?
It's funny, we had a massive rivalry, and you know, she hated me really in some respects because every major championship she would win everything else leading up to it, Grand Prix, you know, World Cup or whatever. But when it came to a major championships, I always went out there and delivered. So she so wanted Olympics, she so wanted the Worlds, but I kept robbing her of it. And it's funny actually because we both retired around about the same time. And then we bumped into each other when we were both working. And we sat there for 4 or 5 hours,
Yeah.
just long lost friends reminiscing. And we did. We have massive respect for each other. And we know that we both helped each other to achieve what we did, really. I mean, the following year, we both broke world records. And we wouldn't have done that unless we were pushing each other. So we needed each other.
So take us through that final.
We had a false start, which, you know, when you're doing it over 400 is a bit of a nightmare. These guys get used to it. And I remember walking back and part of me was going, God, it would have bloody been over by now. Anyway, so just refocused and just said, you know, come on, just get out there. And I knew they were going to go off hard, but I knew exactly my stride pattern. I'd worked out every aspect. I knew they were going to be up on me at 200, but you know, I don't really remember running down that back straight or the fifth hurdle. My key was coming over the eighth hurdle with two hurdles to know, and a trigger mark that I'd worked in my mind is because I knew that if I was in the lead or up there, my best part, similar to this guy, was the last bit.
Yes.
And I knew that if I was up there, it was mine. And I remember coming off that eighth hurdle and saying, right, this is yours, you've got it. And then getting that stride pattern right, because I didn't want to get it wrong like the year before. And I'd worked so hard at getting that right in my mind. I knew exactly what I had to do.
And what were you were thinking on the ground, blocking everything out. What were you like now, after the race, when you've crossed that line?
When you cross the line, I just went through a whole, I just couldn't believe it. You know, I'd, you know, so wanted it and was so hungry for it. And then you feel like somebody's just going to take it away from you. And then you feel like, have I really done that? You know, you just, I don't know, again, I just went back to that sort of doubt in my mind. And, you know, did that really happen? And, you know, it took, you know, a good couple of months for it to really sink in.
Was your fiance now, your husband, Jonathan Bigg, was he close by?
Well, this is a whole funny thing. Not really, no, because he wasn't going to come out. We had always been on the phone and he was always there when I needed him on the phone. And then someone rang him up literally 24 hours and said, right, you need to be out there. And I rang him up and said, look, I've got a ticket here for the stadium. You need to come in. And he managed to get in, and it was a terrible ticket right at the back. And he managed to talk his way into this security lady saying, look, my fiance, he's out there just about to run. Please let me stand by the finishing line.
That should have
And he
been a warning
managed
for you
to,
for the future.
And then he sat on this little step, you know, and watched it from there.
Well, great. Now, what about the relay? You get your bronze.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'll be honest with you. You don't go to a championship. I mean, none of us did. We're all relay runners. But you didn't go to a championship focusing on winning the relay. You didn't train for the relay. I mean, they do now. They do now. They prepare some athletes
big
for a relay.
Big problem there, I think.
Yeah, so, but, you know, absolutely not. So for me, you were dealing with somebody who was injured, but you know, without sounding too arrogant, even injured was good enough to absolutely command a place on the relay team. But you know, I was injured and I wasn't happy and I wasn't comfortable and I was hanging in there. And we won a bronze medal in the relay. And you know, I have to say, Olympic medals are, you know, not all medals are the same. So for David Grinley, I remember, you know, that was it was my first Olympic medal, and I remember him being delighted with it. You know, it was fantastic. But remember, I'd come off being a world champion the year before, and I didn't, it didn't mean much to me. It wasn't what I went to do.